Max Solman, love is a fallacy. Cool was an illogical, Kent, calculating, perspicacious, acute, astute. I was all of this. My brain was powerful as a dynamo, precise, chemist, scales, and penetrating as a scalpel. And think of it, I'm only 18. It's not often that one so young has such a giant intelligence. Take for example, Patty Bellows, my roommate of the university, same age, same background, but dumb as an ox. A nice enough fellow, you understand, but nothing upstairs. Emotion type, unstable, is impressionable, worse of it, fad. This fads, I submit, are the very negation of reason, to be swiped up in every new grace that comes along, to surrender oneself to idiocy just because everybody else is doing it. This, to me, is the acme of mildliness. Not, however, to pity. One afternoon, I found Pity lying on his bed with an expression of such distress on his face that I immediately diagnosed appendix. Don't move, I said. Don't take a laxative. I'll get doctor. Rakonkut, he humbled thinkly. Rakonkut, I said, pushing in my plight. I want a rakonkut, he wailed. I perceived that his trouble was not physical but mental. Why do you want a rakonkut? I should have known it, he cried, bounding his temple. I should have known that they come back when the Clarleston came back. Like a fool, I spent all my money for textbook and now I can get a rakonkut. Can you mean it? I said incredulously, that people are actually wearing rakonkut again. All big men in campus are wearing them. Where have you been? In the library, I said, naming a place not frequented by a big man on campus. He leapt from the bed and passed the room. I got to have a rakonkut, he said passionately. I got to, Pity, why? Look, at rationally, rakonkuts are unnecessary. They shed, they smell bad, they went too much, they add slightly. You don't understand, he interrupted impatiently. It's the thing to do. Do you want to be in the swing? No, I said truthfully. Well, I do, he declared. I give anything for a rakonkut, anything. My brain, that precious instrument, slipped into the higher gear. Anything? I asked, looking at him narrowly. Anything, he affirmed in erring tones. I struck my chin truthfully. It's so happening that I knew where to get my hands on a rakonkut. My father had one in his undergrad days. It's laying in the truck in the attic back home. It's also happened that Pity had something I wanted. He didn't have it exactly, but at least he had first right on it. I referred to his girl, Police P. I had long obeyed Police P. Let me emphasize that my desire for this young woman was not emotion in nature. She was to be sure a girl who excited the emotion, but I was not. Want to lay my heart through my head. I wanted Polly for the shrewdly calculated entire several reasons. I was freshman in a law school. A few years I would be out in practice. As well, aware of the importance of right of kind of wife in furthering a lawyer career. The successful lawyer in had observed almost without exception, married to a beautiful, gorgeous, intelligent woman. With one mission, Polly filtered this specification perfectly. Beautiful she was. She was not yet pin of proportion, but I felt that my would supply the lack she already had that making. Gracious she was. By gracious, I mean full of grace. She had erectness of courage and ease of bearing a poise that clearly indicate the best of breeding. At table, her manner were execute. I have seen her in the cozy campus corner eating the specialty of the house, a sandwich that contained scrap and poilorous, grubby chopped nuts and deeper of Socrates without even her finger moist. Intelligence was not. In fact, she buried in the opposite direction, but I believe that under my guidance she would smarten up. At any rate, it was worth I try. It is, after all, easier to make a beautiful dumb girl smart than to make the ugly smart girl beautiful. Pity, I said. Are you in love with Police P? I think she can't, he replied. But I don't know if you call in love. Why? Don't do you? I asked. Have any kind of formal agreement with her? I mean, are you going steady or anything like that? No. We see each other quite a bit, but we both have other dates. Is there, I asked, any other man whom she has a particular fondness? Not that I know of. Why? No deal with satisfaction. In other words, if you were out of the picture, the field would be open. Isn't that right? I guess so. What are you getting at? Nothing, I said innocently, and I took my suitcase out of the closet. Where are you going? Asked Petey. Home for weekend. I threw a few things into a bag. Listen, he said, clutching my arm eagerly, where are you home? You could get some money from your old man, could you? I lent it to me so I can buy a raccoon coat. I may do better than that, I said, when the mysterious wink and closed my bag and left. Look, I said to Petey. When I got back on Monday morning, I threw open the showcase, revealed the hug-hairy Grammy object that my father had worn in his stock burkat in 1925. Holy Toledo, said Petey. Reverently, he plugged his hand into the round coat and then his face. Holy Toledo, he repeated 50 or 20 times. Would you like it? I asked. Oh, yes, he cried, clutching Miss Chrissy felt to him. Then a canny look came into his eyes. What do you want from it, your girl? I said, meeting no words. Polly, he said, his horrifying whisper. You want Polly? That's right. He plucked the coat from him. Never, he said, stoutly. I shrugged. Okay, if you don't want to be in the swim, I guess it's your business, and sit down to the chair and pretend to read a book. But out of the corner, my eyes keeping watching Petey. He was a turn man. First, he locked the coat with the expression of wife of the bakery window. Then he turned away and sat in jaw resolutely. Then he locked back the coat when the ebon were lagging in his face. Then he turned away, but with not so much resolution this time. Back and forth, he said, swelling, desire waxing, resolution waning. Finally, he did turn away at all. He just stood and started with a mad look at the coat. It is unthought I was in love with Polly, he said thinkingly, or going steady or anything like that. That's right, I murmured. What's a Polly to me, or me to Polly? Not a thing, I said. It just being actual kick, just a few love, that's all. Try on the coat, I said. He complied. The coat butts high over his ears and dropped all the way down in his shoe tops. He looked like a mood of the dragons. Fits fine, he said happily. I rose from the chair. It's a deal? I asked, extending my hand. He swallowed. It's deal, he shake, and I said, I shake my hand. I have my first date with Foley the following evening. This was the nature of survey. I wanted to find out just how much work I have to do to get her mind up in the standard I required. I took her first to dinner. Gee, that was the last dinner, she said, as we left the restaurant. Then I took her to the movie. Gee, that was the Barbie movie, she said as we left in the theater. And then I took her home. Gee, I had sensuous time, she said as she bade me good night. I went back to my room with a heavy heart. I gravely underestimated the size of my task. This girl's lack of information was terrifying, or not would it be enough merely to supply her with information. First, she had to be taught that to think Islam as a project of no small dimensions. And at first I was tempted to give her back to pity, but then I got to think about her abundant physical charms and about that way she entered a room and the way she handled a knife and a fork, and I decided to make an effort. I went about it. As in all things, scientifically, I gave her a course in logic. It happened that I, as a law student, was taking a course in logic myself, so I had all the facts at my fingertips. "Paul," I said to her when I picked her up the out next date, "tonight we're going over the knock and talk." "Oh, terrified," she replied. One thing I will say for this girl, you would go far to find another so agreeable. We went the knock on campus, trying place, and we sat down under the old oak, and she laughed at me expectantly. "What are we going to talk about?" she asked. "Logic." She thought this over a minute. I decided she liked it. Magnet, she said, "logic." I said, clearing my throat, "is the science of thinking. Before we can think correctly, we must learn to recognize the common fallacies of logic. This will take up tonight." "Whoa, though," she cried, clapping her hands delightedly. I wish but went verbally on. "First, let's sample the fallacy called disco simpliciter." "By all means," she beating her lashing ugly. "Dicto expliciter means agreement based on unqualified generalization. For example, exercise, it's good. Therefore, everybody should exercise. Agree?" said Polly earnestly. "I mean, exercise is wonderful. I mean, it's good for the body and everything." "Polly," I said gently, "the agreement in the fallacy, exercise good, is the unqualified generalization. For instance, if you have heart disease, exercise is bad, not good. Many people are ordered by their doctor not to exercise. You must qualify at the generation. You must say exercise actually good, or exercise is good for people. Otherwise, you have committed a disco simplifier. Do you? Do you see?" "No," she confessed. "But this is Mervy." Do more. "It will be better if you stop tugging in my sleeve," I told her. I went, she desisted and continued. "Next, we take a fallacy called hasty generalization. Listen carefully. You can speak French. Petit Bolo can speak French. I must therefore conclude that nobody at the University of Minnesota can speak French." "Really?" said amazed. "Nobody." I had my exasperation. "Fully, it's the fallacy that generalizations is reached too hastily. There are too few instances to support success conclusion. No any more fallacies," she asked breathlessly. "This is more fun than dancing even of thought of and wave despair. I was getting nowhere with this girl, absolutely nowhere. Still, I am nothing if not persistent. I continue. Next come post hoc. Listen to this. Let's not take a bell on our picnic. Every time we take him out with us, it rains." "I know. Somebody just like that," she exclaimed. "A girl back home, Yola Baker, her name is It never fails, every single time we take her on picnic. Polly, I said sharply. It is a fallacy, Yola Bigger does cause the rain. She has no connection with the rain. You are guilty, a post hoc. If you blame Yola Bigger, I never do it again. She promised, contractually. Are you mad at me? I signed. No, Polly, I'm not mad. Then tell me some more false lies. All right, let's try contradictory premises. Let's see. She chirped, blinking her eyes happily. I flowed, but plugging ahead. Here an example of contradictory premise. If God can do anything, can he make a stone so heavy then he won't be able to lift it? Of course, she replied promptly. But he can do anything. He can lift the stone I pointed out. Yeah, she said truthfully. Well then, I guess he can make the stone, but he can do anything, I remind her. She cracked her pretty empty head. I'm all confused, she admitted. Of course you are, because when the premises are agreement contradict each other, there can be no agreement. If there's no irresistible force, there can be no immovable object. If there's immovable object, there can be irresistible force. Get it? Tell me more of this Kent stuff, she said earlier. I consulted my watch. I think we'd better call a night. I take you home now, and you go over all the thing you learned. We'll have another session tomorrow night. I disputed her at the girl. Dormitory, where she assured me she had had perfectly terrific evening, and I went glammy. Home to my room. Pitiless lay snoring in his bed, the raccoon caught oddly like a great hairy beast in his feet. For a moment, I considered walking him into telling him that the could have scared back. It seemed clearly that my project was doomed to failure. This girl simplified, had logic prop head. But then I recognized I have wasted one evening. I might as well waste another. Who knew? Maybe somewhere in the instinct crater of her mind, a few members still smolder. Maybe somehow I could fan them into flame. Admittedly, it was not prospect fraught with hope, but I decided to give it one for more try. Settled under the oak the next evening, I said, our first fallacy tonight called admisericordiam. She quivered with delight. Listen closely, I said. A man applied for a job. When the boss asked him what his qualification are, he replied that he had a wife and 6 children. At home, the wife is heavily crabbed. The children have nothing to eat. No clothes, nowhere, no shoes on their feet. There are no beds in the house. No coal, have nothing. Have cellular inventor is coming. After roll down each fully pink cheeks. When this is awful, awful, she sobbed. Yes, it's awful. I agree, but it's not agreement. That man never answered the boss question about his qualification. Instead, he appealed to be boss sympathy. He committed the fallacy of admisericordiam. Do you understand? I have you get handkerchief, she blabbered. I had her in hardly kerchief and tried to keep from screaming while she wiped her eyes. Next, I said, in a carefully controlled tone, we will discuss false analogy. Here's an example. A student should be allowed to look at their textbook during examination. There now, she said enthusiastically. It's the most marvelous idea I have in a years. Polly, I said testily. The agreement is all wrong. Doctor, lawyers, and carpenters are taking a test to see how much learned our students are. The situation is altogether different, and you can make analogy between them. I still thinking of it a good idea, said Polly. Nuts, a murdered doggedly, I pressed on. Next, we try hypothesis contracted to facts. Sounds yummy, what's poor reaction? Listen, a miracle had not happened to leave a photography plate and a drawer with junk. A pinch of blade, the world today would not know about radium. True, true, said Polly, nodding her head. Did you see the movie? Oh, I just knocked me out. That's why Bidjun is so dreamy. I mean, he fractured me. If you can't forget Mr. Pigeon for a moment, I said loudly. I would like to point out the statement in fallacy. Maybe Madame Corley would have discovered Jung at some later date. Maybe somebody else would have discovered it. Maybe any number of this would have happened. You can start with hypothesis. That is not true, and then the drawer any supportive conclusion from it. The out meme Walter Pigeon more pictures, said Polly. Hardly ever see him anymore. One more chance. I decide, but just one more chance. There's a limit to my flesh and blood can bear. The next fallacy is called poisoning the well. How crucial. Two men are having a debate. The first one gets up and say, my opponent is notorious liar. You can believe a word that he's going to say. Now, Polly, think hard. What's wrong? I watched her closely and she made her creamy brown and constantly, silently, a glimmer of intelligence. The first I had seen came into her eyes. It's not fair, she said with indignation. It's not bit of fair. What change has the second one got if the first one called him a liar before he even begins talking? Right? I cried exultantly. 100% right. It's not fair. The right man has poisoned the well before anybody could drink from it. He has hamstrung his opponent before he could even start. Polly, I'm proud of you. She murmured, blushing with pleasure. You can see, my dear, these things are so hard. All you have to do is concentrate, think, examine, evaluate. Come now, let's review everything we had learned. Far away, she said, with the early wave of her hand, heartened by knowledge that Polly has not altogether accretion. I began a long, patient review of all I had told her, over and over and over again. I studied the instant pointed of flows, keep hammering away without let up. It was like digging a tunnel. At first, everything was work, sweet and darkness, and have no idea when I would reach the light or even if I would, but I persisted. I pounded a claw and a scrapped. I was rewarded. I saw a chink of a light and then a chink of bigger, and the sun came pouring in and all was bright. Five growling night when this talk, but it's not worth it. I have made a logical out of Polly. I have taught her to think. My job was done. She was worthy of me at last. She was fit wife for me. A proper hostess for my mini mansion. A suitable mother for my well children. It must not be thought what that was without love for this thing. Quite the contrary, just a pygmalion love, that perfect woman he had fashioned. So I love mine. I decided to acquaint her with my feeling at our very next meeting. The next had come to change our relationship from academic to romantic. Polly, I said, when next we sit beneath our oak, tonight we will not discuss fallacies. Oh, geez, she said, disappointed. My dear, I said, favoriting her with a smile. We had now spent 5 evening together, we have gotten along splendidly. It's clear that we are much hastily generations, said Polly brightly. I beg your pardon, I said. Hastily generations, she repeated. How you can say that we are much on the basis of only 5 dates? Junk with amusement. The dear child had learned her lesson well, my dear, as he bit in her hand in tolerant manner. 5 dates in plenty. After all, you don't have to eat whole cake to know that's good. False analogy, said Plummy promptly. I'm not a cake. I'm a girl. Chuck with some worldly amusement. The dear child had learned her lesson perhaps too well. I decided to change tactic. Obviously, the best approach was simple, strong, direct declaration of love. I paused for a moment while my massive brain chose the proper words. Then I began to Polly. Polly, I love you. You are the whole world to me. The moon and the star are constellation of outer space. Please, my darling, say that you will go steady with me. For if you will not, life will be meaningless. I will languish. I will refuse my meals. I will wander the face of the earth. Sublime hollow I hung. There's a thought folding my arms that ought to do it. Misericordium, said Polly. A group my teeth. I was not Pedjam alone. I was Frankenstein, and my mother had me by throat frantically fought back the tide of panic through me. At all costs, I had to keep cool. Well, Polly, I said, forcing my smile to certainly have learned your facilities. You are darn right, she said with vigorous nod. And who taught me to you, Polly? You did. That's right, so we do me something, do you, my dear? It had come along, you never would have learned about facilities. Hypothesis, contrary to fact, she said instantly. I dust preparation from my brown Polly. I croak. You must take all of this so literally. I mean, this is just a classroom stop. You know that's the feeling you learn in school. Do you have anything to do with life? The closing flapper, she said, wagging her finger at me playfully. That did it. A limp to my feet, billowing like blood. Will you or will you not go steady with me? I will not, she replied. Why not? I demand, because this afternoon I promised Petty Below that I would go steady with him. He leaned back, overcome with the infamy of it. After he promised, after he made a deal, after he shake my hand, the rat struggled, kicking up great chunk of stuff. You can go with Polly. He's a liar, he's a cheat, he's a rat, poisoning the well, she said Polly, and stop shouting. I think shouting must be fallacy too. With immense effort of will, I modulated my voice. All right, I said, you're a logician. Let's look at the time logically. How could you choose Petty Below over me? Look at me, a brilliant student, a tremendous intellectual, a man with a sure future. Look, Petty, a knockhead, a jitterbug, a guy who never knows where his next meal is coming from. Can you give me one logical reason why you should go study with Petty Below? Certainly I can't, declared Polly. He got a raccoon coat.